On the 12th of December 2022, Azerbaijan set up a blockade in the Armenian populated region Artsakh. The blockade is still there today after 5 months. How does it affect Armenians who have their families there? And how does it affect Armenians who don't?
When I think of my home, I remember all the sounds of the nature because we have a very big garden in our house, and I always go out and sit on the grass and like having picnics with my family or just sitting in the terrace. Well, the first association with Artsakh is my house, and the house is my family.
I think like the very first thing that I can literally smell without having that under my nose is zhangal of huts. It's our traditional dish. I love it very much, and it has like a special, specific, pungent smell that I know. The first picture that comes to my mind is like a lot of greens, like we have trees and flowers like all around the town. It's not like an average urban city, it's so like pristine in that sense. I really love that atmosphere, as if we're like an untouched point in this like world.
I have never been to Artsakh, but when I hear the word, I feel home. I feel connected to the land, and I feel history in there.
The last time I saw my parents was in December, when it just happened so that my parents came to Yerevan just before the blockade has happened, and they got trapped. They had to stay at Yerevan. That was like a really good opportunity for me to spend a lot of time with them, since I'm staying at Yerevan for my studies and they have to leave in Stepanakert. We had like a quality bond time, but then they eventually had to come back. They did find a way to come back to our hometown, and now it's been 5 months that I haven't seen them.
I was home like 2 weeks before the blockade because we had this Thanksgiving holiday in late November, so I went home for 4 days, and it was my last visit. Actually, I was just planning to go back to Stepanakert after the semester ends, because my birthday is also in December. I decided to celebrate my birthday and of course go back home for Christmas, for New Year, to be with my family. But soon after the blockade happened, I realized that it's gonna be serious and it's gonna take a lot of time. This was like the most depressing part of this blockade, because for the first time in my life, I celebrated New Year and Christmas without my family. I was only with my sister, who also studies in Yerevan. We visited our relatives in a village on the border of Armenia and Georgia. It became normal, and it's the worst thing, that it became normal for me not to have access to my home, not to see my family for months. And now I know that probably I will never go home again, because I'm a journalist, I'm sure I'm blacklisted in Azerbaijan. They have some reports criticizing the work I'm doing. So as long as the checkpoint is there, I will have no access to home.
During that period when my family was at Yerevan, they really like seeing like this world of like the capital, like Yerevan. It's like such a cool, amazing place, because Stepanakert is like a small town, and you can't get like and buy fancy things that you can get at Yerevan. So my mom bought a lot of presents and gifts, and she received a lot of them too for Christmas. And when my family had to somehow get back home, they had to use like very uncomfortable means to do so. They had to get like into emergency cars to get like sneaked or like smuggled into the Artsakh under the blockade, and that's why they couldn't afford taking any kind of baggage. They just took like a couple of clothes and that was it. And it really saddens me every time when I come to my aunt's house, that's where they had to stay. I see like this pile of gifts, presents, and like goods and stuff that my mom always wanted to take back home. And I see that it hasn't moved. It just stays there because there is no way for me to forward all of those gifts to her. And every time when I come to Aun's house, I see it as a reminder that there is a blockade and I can't get to my parents and I can't make them happy.
Most of my family is in Stepanakert now and nobody's planning to leave. They will stay there as long as it's possible. But for now, I really want them to come to Yerevan, to see normal life, to see life without a blockade, to see life with electricity, constant electricity, to see supermarkets full of everything, to travel outside of Yerevan. I wouldn't say I want to go home as much as I want them to go out for some time. I know they will return anyway, if there's possible way to go home again. But I know that they're very drained, they're very tired of living like that. Every time I talk to my mom, she starts complaining that it's become very difficult without electricity, without gas for 2 months already, and all these things. So for now, I just want them to go out of this blockade and just see the normal life I'm seeing, like this.
When I feel the pain and the suffering, I always blame myself and I tell myself that you are not there. So the people who are there, who actually are living there, feel more pain and more suffering than you can actually do. This pain is the pain of a nation who survived genocide, who is facing genocide now. We are not safe. It's like you are living in a very criminal, let's say, street, and you don't have your keys to your doors. So your doors are open and there are lots of criminals in there. How you feel? Awful. Because you're constantly in danger of being attacked. So everyone can enter whenever they want, whenever they decide. And it's very similar to the situation that's happening in the country, because we're living in here, but we can every single day hear bad news. Every single day, me and you can go home today. The news might say we were attacked today. We don't know what will happen today, or we don't know what will happen tomorrow. That's it, the frustration, the anxiety that you're living with. As I remember myself, like before 2020, when I was having my history classes talking about wars, I was like, okay, how come someone living in war like for 4 years, for 6 years, you know, we were learning about the wars. I'm like, okay, were they constantly in war? I didn't understand that, but now I see we are in war for not just 2 years, 3 years. We're in this war for a long time.
I hope that it somehow becomes part of Armenia again as it used to be. That really breaks my heart that two countries are trying to compete for it.
In future, well, I guess we as a nation stopped thinking about future. We think about today. First of all, the first thing to be solved is to end the blockade.
I would prefer, first of all, to see Artsakh as part of Armenia, but geopolitically it wasn't possible years ago and it's not possible now. It's like really impossible to become part of Armenia. The other option is become part of Azerbaijan, which Azerbaijan is actively propagating and trying to achieve. And it's not acceptable at all for Armenians and for Artsakh Armenians especially. The other option is to become part of Russia, but I can already exclude this the possibility of integrating into Russia, because Russia won't do it. Russia doesn't need Nagorno-Karabakh as part of its sovereignty, because it will ruin the relationship with other bigger countries. So the only option we have now is just to maintain our so-called independence, because I don't consider ourselves independent anymore. If we are surrounded by Azerbaijan and there is Russian military presence in the region, But as long as it's possible, I would like to see Artsakh independent, like in a way it is, because otherwise people will leave the country. They are already very disappointed, but if it gets worse, people will just leave, and it's the policy of ethnic cleansing that Azerbaijan is trying to achieve. So the only thing we can do now is just to maintain the status that we have now until we become stronger, I mean Armenia as well, so we can reach other decisions on the international arena.